All right, everybody, welcome back for another update on the Blue Nose build. This would be way up to 29. If not, I'll have to re-edit the video. And I don't feel too bad about this. There's one other fellow on YouTube. He's running a longer series than me. I'm probably looking, like I said originally, probably around 40 videos before I get this finished. He is up to his 56th video, and he is working on the Star Trek spaceship, the refit, the Enterprise refit, and that'd be Simon Merks. I don't know if you ever watched his channel, but he's kind of a character, pretty neat guy. But he's up to 56 videos on his build. I think he's been building that model for 10 months now, he said, and he's still got a ways to go yet. I think he said he'd probably be done around the end of February, maybe March. So he's going to be up there in his videos. He's going to top me. So I don't feel too bad, you know, having all these videos up there trying to get this done. I got something to show you. I bought myself a little Christmas gift. I really don't like anybody else buying me models because, you know, who knows what they'll come up with, something off the wall. So I happened to be over to Hobby Store the other day, and I saw something, and I thought, boy, it don't look too bad. And I didn't get it. So then I went back yesterday, and I thought, I'm going to check it out, see if they still got that thing. And I looked and looked. Now, this Hobby Store I go to, it's a big chain. But when it comes to models and things for like this kind of stuff, they don't have nothing. They got one aisle, maybe 20, 25 feet long. And on both sides of the aisle, they got models. And a lot of it is cars. They got some tanks, some Star Trek stuff, a few boats, you know, some planes. But they don't have a lot of anything, and they don't have very much at all. But I saw something, and I thought, I'm going to get that for myself. So I got my very first stash. Now, I won't be working on this for a while, and I thought I'd just get it, hang on to it, put it away. Someday maybe I'll get to it. So this is my very first stash, my one and only. So let me get this for you. Right here. And you see that? There you go. That is two ships in this one box. You got the Dresden and the Edmund? I don't know. Anyway, there's two ships in the one box. Now, they're both basically almost the same model. I think the difference in it is one of them has four propellers and the other one has two. I'm not going to get it out. I'm not going to do a review on it because that's not what this video is about. But I just wanted to show you I got my very first stash. Kind of proud of that. Don't have a lot of room in this apartment to put anything, but I'll find room to put one model somewhere. But I think this was about $35. I probably could have found it a couple bucks cheaper on the internet. But I was watching a video the other day of a fellow, and he says, you know, more or less, pay your respects to these local model shops because there ain't too many of them around. You know, if you can go in there and buy something from them once in a while, maybe you'll spend a few more bucks. But it keeps them in business, and it does help you out because they do have stuff like I showed you, all that brass you can go over there and get. You don't have to get on the internet and order all this stuff. They do have a lot of things over there I can buy from them that I can't find nowhere else. But and when it comes to their models, they are a little pricey. I've seen some stuff over there for 80, 90 bucks. And I know you can get it on the internet for around 50 or 60. So, I thought $35, that ain't bad. And I was looking on the internet, I was reading some reviews on this and that. It's by Revell. And they say it's not a bad model. It's really not. There ain't a whole lot to it. I think for both ships there's 200 and some odd parts. So there's not a lot there. But, you know, it's something to mess with. And they do have a photo etch for it. And they also have a wooden deck set that you can send away for and get that. Because I understand one of the biggest hang-ups on this is the deck that they have on here. It's molded out of plastic. Guys say it's way out of proportion. So I just might do that. I might send away for that little wooden deck set and the photo etch. At least one of them will be set up that way. All right. So that's my first stash. All right. So we're going to get to the ship. You can probably see it behind me sitting there on the bed. I've been working on the bowsprit. Got all the rigging done on the bowsprit. And I've got a little clip coming up. I'm going to show you how I did my seizing or sizing. I'm not sure how you say that. My son went to college. He spent 5 years in college, got 2 degrees. I will ask him. You know, I paid that kind of money for it. He can at least tell me how to pronounce it right. So anyway, I got a little short clip of that coming up. But I'm going to show you some stuff here. Some of this string and stuff that they give you, I wasn't happy with it. And I'll show you that in a minute once I get the camera turned around. So I think we're going to have a little long video here again. And I think that's about it. Took me about 2 days to get the bowsprit done. Wasn't that difficult. I also spent a little time working on the thing on the deck where the dory gets stored. I made that. I'll show you that too. I haven't got it glued down or stained or anything yet, but I did get it made so I can get that little boat on the deck. All right, so let me get the camera turned around, and I'm going to show you what I got going on here and talk to you about some of this string and some of the stuff I got in order to do this rigging. All right, let's get it turned around. All right, so here we are. Got a string laid out. I went through the box. I'm pretty sure this is all they give you. I have to look. I don't know if there's any more in there or not. But this is what they give you with the model, all right? 3 blacks and 2 shades of brown. I don't get that, but... first thing you're going to need... Now, let me start off by saying this. This is the way I do it, okay? I've watched, you know, a lot of videos out there on this stuff. Guys have got different opinions about using certain things and doing things a certain way. So this, once again, is my way. Now, I use beeswax. I went over to Hobby Lobby, and I bought me a big brick of this. I think this thing was about this big. And this will probably last my grandkids' grandkids. I broke this little piece off, and I used it on the Bounty. Now I'm using it here. I haven't even begun to use this thing up. The amount of beeswax I have got will last me and my grandkids' grandkids. So, but you're going to need something. I use beeswax. I've heard some guys using candle wax. Some guys using a mixture of stuff. You know, it's whatever you want to do. You know, get on the internet, research it, and do your thing. But for me, the beeswax is working a little bit. It works pretty nice. It's got its hang up. But I've found a way to overcome that. Now, what I did is, when I built the Bounty, I went over and got my own string from Hobby Lobby. Or you can go to Joann Fabrics or wherever. Get yourself some string. And that, once again, there's websites on there. What type of string? Should I use cotton? Should I use nylon? Should I use a combination? Or, you know, all kinds of stuff. Well, you know, it's no one has a set standard for this. You just got to use your head. I'm using cotton. This one roll here says it's cotton. This one isn't marked. There's no markings on it, but I'm 100% positive that's cotton. This came from Constructo from the Bounty. I had to order some more because I ran out. This here, I believe, is cotton. Now, what they're giving you with the model, I have no idea what it is. I guess maybe if I got into the directions or the book or whatever and looked and see, they might tell you what they're giving you. But let me tell you something. I'm not real happy with this stuff. Let me see. I think it was the larger one here that I pulled off. I was going to use on my Bowsprit. And you can see it right here. After taking it off of that little spool, look at it. Looks like a piece of wire. And it even feels like a real thin piece of wire. And I've done everything I can to stretch this out and get the kinks out of it. Look, watch it. You know, I don't know what the heck that stuff is. If they got it coated with something or what it is. It looks nice. You don't see any little fuzzies on it or anything that you get with cotton. But I'm not real happy with the way, you know, you're going to really have to pull on that. And I mean pull on it to get the kinks out of it and make it look decent. So, the first thing off, I'm not going to use it. I'm not satisfied with that. At least that's on the big one, on the big spool. I believe the other ones are the same. That feels the same way. Look how stiff it is. So that's why this cotton here is nice, you know. This here is a piece of this cotton that has been waxed already. And you can see by waxing it, it gives it some rigidity. But at the same time, it stays nice and flexible, okay? It don't take a whole lot of pressure on it to straighten it out. So that's what I'm going with. I'm sticking with my cotton. And you can go over there and get all sizes, all types of sizes. And you can match up the colors and everything. So that's it for that. Now, I've got one complaint, naturally, another complaint with Model Shipways or Model Expo. Model Expo is the company that runs Model Shipways. They give you in the plans here. Now let me turn around. I'm gonna read some of these numbers off. Now this is the rigging they're telling you to use on this black stuff, because this is the running or the standing rigging. They're telling you to use a 0.010 on one of the lines. Another line is 0.008 and another line is 0.017. Okay. How hard would it be for them to put some type of marking on there to tell you what size this string is? They tell you that in the plans. And then don't mark the string so you know what you're using. Now, I got my grandfather's set of, what do you call these? Micrometer? Okay. And I tried measuring this stuff. Come on, you know, you're getting down so fine that it's just... How hard would it be for them to mark that stuff? Come on. I even tried measuring it with my caliper. All right? I gave up. So I just took this over here, this cotton, which was pretty much, you can see, the same size as what they're giving me. All right? So it's pretty much guesswork. You use whatever size you feel comfortable with. I know the shroud lines are fairly thick, so I'll probably be sticking with the thickest one here. I think this is the thickest one right here. That's this. And the rat lines that go in on the shroud lines are a little bit thinner, so I'll be using a thinner string on that. But, you know, it does not have to be this damn complicated. Why can't they mark their damn lines? All right, my little rant. But I'm not real happy with this stuff. I don't know what this stuff is made out of. I tried taking two pieces of it like this. I was taking a piece and I was holding it together and putting a dab of super glue on there. I couldn't get it to hold. It just kept coming apart. So I don't know what that stuff's made out of. But it's weird. Looks nice. I mean, it looks like a real small miniature rope. But I'm not happy with it. Okay, we're going to interrupt this video here because I should have had my act together. This is the next day. I should have had my act together and had this done yesterday when I made this video. But, you know, you get so much stuff on your mind and things just don't go your way when you're trying to make one of these videos. I did go through the box and I found another spool of brown. I found this one here. I had it in another container. So you actually got, they give you six little spools here of string. You got three black and three brown, two different colors of brown. Now I found out what it was. Went through and I forgot I had this, but the parts list. Let me turn my little lens around. Okay, I found the parts list. And it gives you a list of the string they give you. And on this right here it says rigging line, and it tells you the rigging line is a cotton poly mix. Now by poly I guess they mean polyester. I'm not sure, but it says cotton poly mix. The brown is a manila hemp, okay? And they also give you how many yards are on each one of them little spools, and they give you the diameter of each one. Now, the three black are the same as the three brown as far as diameter goes. There's three different sizes on each. Now, here comes the fun part. Okay, these three diameters they give you do not match, of course, what is on the big sheets of plans. All right, they do have a 0.008. That's the only number I've seen that matches. The other two diameters don't match the other two. So, what's new? But that's only part of it. Okay, in the book of directions. Down here, rigging line and block sizes. Lines on the plan. They have three measurements over here, three diameters that tell you are on the plans. Those three diameters I didn't see on the plans. At least what I got on the plans is a 0.010. A 0.008 and a 0.017. None of those numbers are over here. And they tell you what was supplied in the kit, lines in the kit. 0.009, there's no point zero, there's 0.017. No, that ain't what it says here. Up here. 0.030, no. So their numbers that they're telling you in the book, that the lines in the kit, don't match with what they're telling you on the parts list. Okay? And then you go back here. All right. Rigging line diameters. There's 20 numbers there. To change it from millimeters to the fractions of an inch. All right? And like I said, in the kit, 0.021. There's no 0.021 on here. 0.028. There's no 0.028 on here. Here's some more numbers. I give up. I go out and get your own. Just go out and buy your own. All right, That's all I can say. I give up. Just let's get on with the rest of the video. It's long enough as it is. I you don't need to see me go blah, 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 crazy over this. So, all right, let's go. All right, so let me tell you something here. This beeswax, when you do your lines, all right, what I like to do is I'll run this string through this beeswax maybe 5 or 6 times this way, and then I'll flip it over and run it 5 or 6 more times. And then I take this string and I put it in my fingers and pull on it with a nice good tug, trying to heat up with the friction of my fingers that beeswax to melt it into that line. Alright? And you gotta be careful, because if you pull too hard, you'll burn the tips of your fingers. Now, you go using this stuff and you start tying knots on it or doing what you got to do, and you'll start seeing some of that beeswax start like flaking off, little pieces of it. And you think it's your string, you know, the fuzzies on your string popping up, but it's not, it's the beeswax. Now, I've heard of all kinds of ways of doing this. Guys make they melt this stuff down and it'll run the string through it. You know, taking a light bulb and running it across the light bulb to heat it up to melt the wax. But I found a little trick here that I'm going to share with you, and it just came to me and I thought, well, I'm going to give this a shot, and it works. So what I done was I took, let me see if I can get this over here so you can see what I got. You see if it'll reach. I don't think it's going to reach. But this here is my soldering iron, all right? And you can see the dial on the front. If I can get it up, I'm pulling on the plug. All right, I've got that dial. It goes down to the last reading is 392. And then like 1 or 2 more little clicks and it's off. So I'm down to where you turn it off and just barely got it to come on. I'd say I'm probably around 200 degrees. I'm just guessing. I can't tell. I have no way of knowing. So I'd say I'm around 200 degrees on that tip. So what I've been doing was, once I get my string on there, and I will show you in the little clip I'm going to do, but once I get my string on there, and if you see any of that white beeswax, you'll see it if you've got your magnifiers on. I'll take this soldering iron and just run it across that string real fast, and it melts that beeswax, and then take my fingers and go like that, and it's gone. It melts it right into that string. And especially when you're doing any sizing or seizing, you'll really notice it, because once you start bending it and twisting it and turning it, a lot of that stuff starts flaking off. So if you just run this across that real fast, melts that beeswax right in there, and it's gone. So that's, you know, my little trick for the day, or tip. But be careful. Don't hold that soldering iron on that string, or you'll burn right through it. But down to my lowest setting, it seems to work all right. I just keep it moving. I don't keep it in one spot. And it, all you got to do is just touch it, and it melts it right now. But that's the kind I got to where you can adjust the setting on it. I got my Coke here today because my voice keeps going out. So, that's where I'm at with that. But it just really upsets me, you know. They give you all this stuff, throw it in the box, and then want you to guess at what it is. Because, you know, I guess you could figure it out by figuring what fraction that is and what's the smallest one of each one. But why two different shades of brown? I don't get that. I don't know if that is brought up anywhere. I'd have to look at the directions. I really didn't look at them that good. And this one here is really, really thin. That is, that's about the size of a hair right there, this one here. So I'm going to have to get in there and look and see what the different colors are for. And let me tell you something else, and this is real important. What they got on one of these spools right here, this right here, this one spool, this is the bigger one. I guarantee you, I will throw away that much. That will be waste from me working on this ship, probably that much right there. So to me, that's about half of what you should get on this model. Because if you look over here, you can see I've been working on that bowsprit. This is all little pieces that's left over from me working on it. I like to cut my string a little bit longer so that when I got to tie a knot, I got something to work with. Makes it a lot easier if you got some extra length. But then when you got extra length, you got extra waste. But this one right here, $2.79 for that over at Hobby Lobby. And that's probably half of what it was originally, because like I said, I used that on the bounty. But you're going to have a lot of waste. There's no getting around it. And I do not think that that is near enough. And like I said before, I'd hate to be starting and using my ship with this and then all of a sudden run out and then switch over to this and you might see a difference on it. So I'm just going to start out with this and use this all the way through the ship. If I run out, I go right over to Hobby Lobby and get me another little spool. No big deal. But if you run out of this, now you're trying to get a hold of MicroMart or Model Expo, I'm sorry, and try to order that not knowing what size it is. So good luck on that. And I had the same problem on the bounty. You know, they had a spool of this that I was using, and I ran out. And it was the same thing, 0.025 or something like that, and 0.50, and I didn't know what size it was, so I had to order both. And then when I got them, and this was for their ship, and when I got it, neither one of them, the color was a shade off. So here I am. I've got two different shades of this brown on my bounty, and it's supposed to be the same, you know, I guess they got a different manufacturer to make it or something, and the color came out different. So that's why I say, I go over, I buy my own string, buy what you want, buy the nylon, whatever you feel happy with. Read some of the articles on some of them forums about string and make your own decision. But I really suggest you go over to the fabric store and buy a couple of these so there's no running out. Okay, I'm going to get on to the ship here and show you a little bit. And then at the end, I got a clip on how I did the bowsprit. I got the bowsprit done. So let me get the camera turned off and turned around, or get the ship over here, I should say. All right, so here's the ship. And I know you guys keep seeing it with the mast in there, but they are not in there permanently yet. That's going to be a while yet. They haven't got that far. Although it's not that far off. Here's the little thing I made right here. Not 100% complete yet. I've got some little blocks I have to come up on here that match the hull, the little ship, the little boat, the dory. Okay? Comes up on here on this, but that's pretty much it. I notched out these little pieces and then notched this out and put it together, and that will sit right up on here. I'm only going to make one, and I notice it doesn't sit level because the deck is pitched. So when I go to glue it down, I'm going to have to sit here for a few seconds and hold this thing down so I can get it on there right. But I'm only going to put one of them on there. All right. And then the little dory will sit up on here like that. Okay. So I got that done. And I can go ahead, I probably can get this glued on here, and I'm just going to go ahead and put some clear polyurethane on it. I probably could have made this thing out of my walnut, but I never thought of it. And get this glued down. I got to put some little eye hooks in it so you can tie this off onto the deck. Alright, so knocking that out. Alright, so here's my bowsprit. Can you see it? And I got some better shots of it coming up. But I got her all rigged up. Let me bring her up a little bit to you. Trying to keep it in focus. There we go. Alright, so I got the bowsprit all rigged up. Got those little turnbuckles on there. My foot ropes on there. My little strings hanging down for the tying up the sail if you had it down. Furled. And that took me about a day and a half. Between this and the bowsprit was 2 days worth of work. Wasn't that difficult at all. Like I said, I had all the parts made. All the turnbuckles were already made. All I had to do is just string her all up, rig it up. All right, so I got a little clip coming up, and I'm going to show you how I'm going to have to find out. Is it sizing or seizing? I have to look it up. Anyway, it's a process where you got your rope coming down, and you wrap rope around it to tie it off. And you'll see what I'm talking about. I'm going to show you a short little clip of that, of me doing one of these turnbuckles and getting that set up. Let me have another drink of my Coca-Cola. Okay, so we'll have a little short clip of that, and then I got some close-ups of it, and I think that'll do it for this video for the week. Not sure where I'm going next. You know, like I said, things are getting kind of crazy now. It's getting into almost Christmas, and me and the wife are running and doing Christmas shopping and putting up the tree. I hate putting them lights on a tree. I'd rather take a beating than put them lights on a tree. But it's just, you know, it's the wrong time of the year to be working on models because we got so much other stuff going on. Trying to get presents for the grandkids. I don't care about anybody else. As long as the grandkids got a good Christmas, I'm happy if they're happy. So I'm working on it here and there. You know, I was really pleased to get this bowsprit done. That was a big thing. Starting to get dust on it. That's one thing I got to think about when I get this done, is getting a case made for it. I am not going to go out and spend $400 or $500 for a glass case. I'm probably going to try and see if I can make my own. I don't see really that much problems in it. I'll probably make it out of plexiglass. I'll try that first and see how it holds up down the road. If it doesn't work, I'll take the plexiglass out and replace it with glass. But I'm going to try and make my own. Excuse me. But it's going to have to be a monster. Because, you know, this is a pretty good sized ship. So it's going to have to be a pretty good tall case. All right. I'm going to show you the little clip. And I think that'll be it. So thanks for watching. And I'll see you again next week. Okay. I'm going to show you here how I do my sizing or seizing. I don't know how you pronounce it. I'm going to have to ask my son. He's got 5 years of college. He'll tell me. So I'm going to show you how I do mine. This is how I do it. Now there's other guys that do it other ways, but this is my way. Alright. I got some beeswax. And I got a length of string. We're going to do this turnbuckle right here. I found it's easier to do the turnbuckle first. While it's hanging, I only got one turnbuckle on each end of the string. All right. So I got a piece of string that's long enough to go from down around here to here with some left over. All right. So now I'm going to run this string through my beeswax. And I'd usually pull it maybe about five times this way. All right. I don't know if I'm in view. All right. And then I'll flip it over so I can catch the other end of it and do it about five more times. All right. Now I'm going to take this string and try and run it through my fingers as tight as I can hold them fingers on there and pull it, and try to get the friction from my fingers to melt that beeswax a little bit into that string. All right. Now, I have seen guys do this where they can get it to squeak. I've had that happen a couple times, but it's no big deal. And also, it gets off any big chunks of the beeswax that might be stuck on there. All right. Now be careful with this, because you will burn the ends of your fingers if you're not careful. All right, that's enough. All right, now stick the end of this. All right, I got to get my glasses off and get my magnifiers on, because you know how it is. You get older, you get blind. And I got to readjust here. All right. I'm going to try and get the end of this into that hole. Hold on. Helps to lick the end of it a little bit. Just like you're threading a needle here. Now trust me, I haven't had this much trouble on any of the other ones. It went right in there. There it is. All right, then I pull it down. This is why you got some extra string. I guess I got about an inch and a half left over there. I'm going to take a pair of these forceps here. All right. And I'm going to clamp them on here, right or anywhere down out of the way, and just let it hang. Okay. Now, let me see if I can close in a little bit more for you. Let me readjust this camera. All right. It's a little, a little too high right there. All right. Now I'm going to take another piece of string and get it cut. Oh, I don't know what that is, 6-7 inches. Get yourself a pair of these scissors here. These are the greatest little things. And be careful, because they are sharp. Then I'm going to do the same thing. Run this through some beeswax. Okay, I just ran that through some beeswax like I did the other one. Now I'm going to wrap this around here and tie off a half knot, whatever you want to call it. And get my tweezers for this. It's so much easier to have a pair of tweezers to tie knots with. All right, and just kind of snug it up a little bit here. Now I want to get this right up to the bottom of that turnbuckle. Once again, let me get my magnifiers on here and bring this right up to the bottom of that turnbuckle. And pull that as tight as I can get it. Right there. Now, on these other ones I did, okay, these other ones on the other side, I was bringing this extra piece down here and wrapping all three of them. I found out I get a little bit better look if I leave this one hanging. Just, I'll cut that off later. So just leave that one out of the way. Now I'm going to take this string and kind of hold on to my forceps or whatever they're called, so this string just doesn't twist on me. And start wrapping this string around here. Now I like to do about 8 or 9 times. That
8 or 9 turns, comes out about 3/4 of an inch, 1/2 inch, which looks nice for me. Now you got to pull it up and keep it tight. All right. Pull it up and keep it tight. Come on around again. Now this is easy here because this is hanging down and there's nothing to it. When I bring the other turnbuckle from in the back and I got to tie off up here, it gets kind of little tight space right there to try and feed that string through. So this here is easy, so I thought I'd show you this so you can see how I do this. But just keep it up tight. Pull up on it, and if you have to, use your fingernail to keep them up tight against each other. Each one of them loops. Come on around again. Naturally, I lost count. Anybody been keeping count for me? See, I'm one of them kind of guys, I can't talk when I'm concentrating, because then I lose my train of thought and what I'm doing. I can't tell you how many times me and the wife have gone for a ride in the car and I'll get to talking, next thing you know, she's asking me, where are we going? You're making a wrong turn. So I can only concentrate on one thing at a time. I kind of know about how long I want this, so I lost count of the wraps. I think that's about it. Alright. Now, I'm using this here super glue right here. This is about the only time on this ship I will use super glue. And I gotta put a little dab on my paper here. Alright. Get my toothpick. Get a little bit of that on the end of my toothpick and touch this off. Just a little dab. You don't want a whole lot on there. And pull this string on around into that glue and tighten it up. And kind of smash it with your fingers. Okay. So that should hold there for a few minutes. Be nice and tight. So while that's holding, and I'm waiting for that to dry, I'm going to cut this other one off. Let me get it down here out of the way. I'm going to get as close as I can to that turnbuckle. Or to the knot, right there. And I'm going to take my super glue again. A little dot. I'm going to touch this off so this knot won't come undone up here. Okay. And smash that together with your fingers. Make this look nice and pretty. It's what you want. Nice and pretty. Alright. Now I'm going to cut this string off. The one I was wrapping. Let me get this toothpick out of my mouth. Can't talk with stuff in my mouth either. Cut that one off. Take these clamps off. Take this extra piece of string. Bring it up there. Separate them. And cut that off as close as I can get it. Give me another little dab of glue. Little dab will do ya. How many guys know what that's a commercial from? Alright, put some glue on there. Smash it all together with your fingers. Smash the whole thing together. There you go. Alright. Now here's something else I've done, and I'll probably have explained this earlier in the video because this is one of the first parts of the video I shot, so I don't want to do a bunch of double talk. But here's my heating iron, and I can look at this and I can see some of that white beeswax where the beeswax is. Just run it across there, melt that beeswax on into that string. And do not hold it on that string, you burn right through that string. Okay. There you go. That's how I do it. Let me back out a little bit. Oh, hey, wrong way. Okay. Let me put my other glasses on so I can see what you're seeing. All right. Now this one here will come back. And you can see I cut it pretty long, but that's why it's nice to buy the string from the hobby store. As you can buy a couple rolls of it and you can have plenty of it. And that's going to go through this little ring back here on the back. Okay. And then I will pull that up as tight as I can get it. Tie off a knot here and do the same thing. Wrap it. Alright. I've got this turnbuckle back here already done. So I'll bring that one up here to the same spot I was just at. Pull it as tight as I can get it. And wrap it. Now that's a little tricky up there because there's not a whole lot of room. You got to try and feed that string in and out there. And then I got my little foot rope here, which comes up to the front like that. Just hangs there. I'm just tying a knot off on that. I ain't gonna do no seizing on the end of that. All right, so that's how I did that. That's how I did my little turnbuckle up here, and you can see I got my little ropes here that are for the tying off the sails. They got to go in behind there, and I'll probably have to get something to hang on there to straighten them out, or maybe if I run the iron across them, the soldering iron might loosen them up a little bit, straighten them out. All right, so that's how I do it. A couple more to go and that bowsprit's done. Okay, well there she is. I got the bowsprit done. Got those two lines in come from the side. One turnbuckle here on the top one, because I figure they can reach over the edge of the rail and do that turnbuckle. And then this one down here comes up and the turnbuckle's up on the front. And then there's two turnbuckles on the bottom on these two lines. And it's the same way on the other side. There's the little foot rope in there. Right in there. Yeah, right there. This needs to be pulled on a little bit to stretch it out. And then there's the little ropes hanging down that tie up the sail when she's down. So the bowsprit's done with the rigging. Of course, you know, I got all the rigging that goes on the top up to the mast yet and the sail rigging. But I got the bowsprit. All that done. Let's see if I can turn it a little bit so you can see it. Let me flip my lens thing here. I ain't got much room back there. But you get the idea of what she looks like. I'm trying to get you a better view. Let me stand up here and see if I can zoom in a little bit. Okay, so those little turnbuckles turned out pretty nice. If you ask me, there's one right there that they wanted you to do. That's out of their suggestion of how to do them. It almost looks just a tad too big, but that's their brass wire that they gave you, that brass strip. So it looks pretty good. I'm satisfied with it. I can't complain. So, got that part done. All right, that's it for that.